Good morning, everybody, and welcome to New Living Expo. Is everybody having fun this weekend?
Yes.
Yeah.
Of course, the New Living Expo is always about holistic health and spirituality and looking into the meaning of life, sort of separating, you know, our realities and finding new modalities, let's say that. I've known Mary Edwards for a little while here. We were just at UFOCon, and she's so delightful, so interesting in her approach to healing, but also other things, worldly events, extraterrestrials, certainly. And today's presentation is her story of awakening, as you can see. We'll be presenting a festive of human interactions with extraterrestrials, which we have every day of our life. You just can't see them anyways, right? And then she has her art and design, and of course, that's Dad up there, who's on the other side. Every once in a while, he comes through. So I'm really thrilled to introduce Mary Edwards because I find her delightful, charming, and very informative. Please welcome the very lovely Miss Mary Edwards.
Thank you, dear. Well, hello, everyone. It's great to have you here. I'll just dive in. I talk fast, and I packed a lot in, so I'll just keep speeding along, and hopefully we'll have time for some questions afterwards if you'd like. As Rob said, that's my dad up there, and me when I was 5 years old, or a little bit older than that when I first went on a craft. But anyway, hello, I'm Mary Edwards, and I'm happy to see you all here today. Today I share the story of my life, family, and ET experiences in a story of awakening. I'm presenting another facet of experience of ET-human interactions with ET. It's a multi-generational overview of connecting inner and outer space and how blending art, design, and architecture is our connection to otherworldly environments and ET. This is my truth and understanding after putting the pieces of my puzzle together over the decades of my wild, wonderful, and complex life. Let us begin. Exploring my ancestral blueprint, I see a thread of healing and design that connects my lifetimes. I'm an artist, interior designer, teacher, author, contactee, and hybrid mother. I host Connecting with the Stars with Mary Edwards on Conscious Awakening Network on Apple TV, Roku, and YouTube. I'm a co-author of the children's book, Real Adventures with ET Friends in Space, based on real accounts with Barbara Lamb, that shares stories of friendship and learning between human kids and ET. I helped design the interiors of the International Space Station as a contractor with NASA and spent my career enhancing thousands of spaces from homes to retail to hospitals, locally and globally. As a child, I had many passions related to interior space as I wanted to be an artist, an interior designer, and an astronaut. Growing up with rocket scientist father and grandfather, an architect, grandfather, my mother's father was an architect, and an artist mother and grandmother inspired these passions to be woven into one into my life. I wrote to NASA at age 9 to apply to be the first woman astronaut. I thought it was sort of a gift that my father and my uncles were, but I didn't see any women out there, so I was on a mission to get there at some point someday. And this is their response, which I happened to find in piles of stuff my mom was throwing away a few years ago when she was passed, from 1960, that they were actually responded to me back then and said, thank you for your interest in the space civilization and the space future. So as you can see, I was already, and then this, that's me as a child, growing up with a grandfather that was an architect, taught me about Earth space, and then my grandfather and my father taught me about outer space. So I was always looking at the stars as well as looking into designing spaces and places for people. So as you can see, I was already interested in interior design and space as a young girl. This picture was actually for the cover of the Chicago Tribune. I grew up outside Chicago, and my grandfather, who standardized the 2x4, was going around, and we were going around the country talking about being careful with how lumber was sold. He and his father had an architectural company and a design build company and also a lumber yard, and he was so freaked out about the waste of wood, the way wood was sold before the 2x4 was invented, with Frank Lloyd Wright in our neighborhood that grew up near us, and all the developments that were going, of course, out of Chicago forever. And he was actually the one who standardized 2x4. So I actually grew up with sustainability too as a key factor that I've done practiced on my life as much as I could. My relationship with NASA continued into the 1960s, as you can see from this slide. On this Newsweek cover, Goodbye to the 60s, I'm near the era protesting the Vietnam War at New College in Cambridge, Mass. That time in history is very similar to the time now as we are protesting then against, we protested then about, against war and wanted to live in peace, love, unity, and harmony as we do today. My father and grandfather and my daughter also worked at NASA, with NASA in different aspects, and so did I, so we had five generations of us that worked, and two women, which I thought was sort of fun. I also remember the headline, Small Step for Man, Giant Leap for Mankind, and the narrator's comment below in this small article clip I got. Science fiction had now become science fact. Well, look at how long it's taken, it still is not. It was then. Why has it taken so long to get us where we are now? Woo-hoo, 1969, goodbye. Here we are, 2023, still asking the same questions. Then I happened to work at the Boulder design firm. I worked at multifaceted design firms for 34 years, and we happened to be working on the Star Trek logo 40 years ago, too. So as I followed this, my pattern, it's always been about NASA, 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 space, 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 and also developing it graphically, interior-wise, and sort of spiritually within. I was excited when Dr. Von Clearwater hired me as a contractor team to work at Moffett Field to be included in the brand new Space Human Factors Office in the early 1990s. She interviewed about 340 of us. We had to be either involved with architecture or design. We had to have travel globally, and we also had to be working at a university. And I was teaching at the Academy of Art College 4 nights a week while I was running my practice and working for another firm at the time, too. So I was lucky enough to be selected to help build a team at Moffett Field to work on, our mission was to de-stress astronauts and create a multi-sensory interior, multi-dimensional interior, really, that was functional, cross-cultural, and personal. For the first, we were working with ESA, the Japanese, so it was the first real international space station. And my father said, why'd they hire you, rocket scientist? And I said, well, Dad, you sent the monkeys up and the Soviets up, like, and the dogs, and they all died, and it was all just a cold capsule. We're gonna try to change that, and he really laughed. But, you know, it was my mission to create, to help the 25 of us really help create a more livable work, live space. And I used to say it was like designing a mobile home park that goes from day till night, every hour and a half, in zero gravity. Now back then they were attached to Velcro, kicking each other in the face. I designed the first sleep restraints that actually attached the men and women astronauts to the wall. We designed foot restraints. We tried to ground them to the ground to create as much of a work environment as we could in this small floating mobile home park. We created a large lookbook to detail suggestions for a more livable environment. And the couple of years we worked on this project, I kept bugging Dr. Von Clearwater and our male team. I said, we need to test pupillary dilation and heartbeat according to some of these materials and suggestions. We're doing earth-ground orientation. You know, when you're floating around, why not create sky and earth as much as we could? You said, this is my drawing here. You can see the dark, the bottom was obviously ground. We couldn't really do a lot with the space, obviously. But we were doing many different tests. So they built us a full-size mock-up, and we tested 1,832 people in it, some astronauts and other people, to test pupillary dilation, heartbeat, and how their body responded to some of the colors that we used. I mean, it wasn't just Laura Ashley stuff, but it was really looking at how we could color code, create personalization spaces. NASA actually bought about 500 of my photographs that I already traveled a bunch with my parents growing up, which was incredible. That we tested out at off-planet spaces, outposts in Alaska to Antarctica. Like, we took them pictures. I said, it's probably gonna be like the Hams Brewery ad from a long time ago. No people, no architecture, just beautiful picture, images of nature. And that's what, of course, after 2 years of work and all these different tests that we did, the astronauts really just want, you know, they were seeing obviously the beautiful cosmos out their windows, but having earth brain and earth nature was really important to them. And I've always, in my interior design on earth and off, which you'll hear about in a minute, I've always brought the outdoors indoors. That's one of my taglines, not only creating happier, healthier environments, but bringing the outdoors indoors so we connect to ourselves, nature, more every day when we see beautiful images. We all know that. We see that. We are all touched by the magic of the universe and Father Sky and Mother Earth. So overall, we worked with many aspects of human control in the space station, and we're delighted that they incorporated many of the things that we suggested and tested. And of course, the increased productivity was what they really wanted to hear about, but we did that. We really focused on a lot of culture. Some of the images that we did were more maybe Japanese or European in spirit. So it was really trying to weave together culture, which I wanted to, loved doing my whole life. I was lucky enough to start traveling with my parents. They took me to Stonehenge when I was 6 years old. We went to China when I was in like 15 years old. We went to South America. We went to Africa on a 1 month safari, living in the Serengeti for a month with the animals. And my dad and I were always out there when I was 10 or 15 or 20 or 25. I wanted every free trip I could for my whole life. And we always had our Nikons, and we were taking pictures of the night sky and animals and critters on ships and everywhere we went. It was just Indonesia, the Philippines, and Singapore. And my dad has told me recently, I said, why did you take me? Why was I the only daughter that went on all these trips? He said, I knew you got the wiring that you got, and I wanted you to see more because of all the space travel. And he said, for your future. He didn't talk about the space travel, but he said it was all for your cultural awareness and involvement and exposure to how people live, because he said you've been obsessed by that. You also wanted to be another A. I wanted to be an anthropologist. So I was always a very eager little girl to learn everything I could about people and the planet and the sky and Earth. So I was taken on a spacecraft at age 5 with my father. Because of my experiences on board the crafts and dealing with ET, I began drawing images or impressions of what I could slightly remember, the fragments of my memories. You see several here. They took eggs also for me on that trip, 978 eggs, I was told by my beings on and off over the years. I made these paintings here after the trip as my own personal visual memory and validation, I guess, even back at age 5. I went back again without my dad at age 6 on a larger craft, and then again at 10 on a really big craft, and I'll talk about that in a little while, but I know back then they were training me, exposing me to different things so I could continue sort of my family lineage that my dad, my father, my grandfather had been doing off planet that I didn't know until literally a few months ago. Many contactees share the similar stories of being taken to only having glimpses. People ask me all the time, what did you see on the craft? And I said, I'm so hypersensitive, like many of us are, as empaths and clairvoyance and all the different things that we are sitting here. But I was so hypersensitive to the lights on the craft, the cold, my cold naked body. I did a really simple drawing here. And there were the three grays, which is very typical, and then a couple of Arcturians that I learned later. And my dad was there, and I heard later on that his father took him at age 5, his grandfather took his dad at age 5. So we go back about 100 generations of Pleiadian, Arcturian, Syrian, like we all do, different DNA. So it's been fascinating now talking to him the last few months and learning all this finally for the first time in my life after not being told anything because he was in the military and the government. So as I got to go back, as many contactees share similar stories of being taken, I only have glimpses of the bright lights, cold tables, and a few others until I blinked out. I don't remember much about these flashes that I saw and still see in my mind as real as they are as I sit here today. I'll talk about that further in my presentation. Art to me is and equals ET's visual aid to document their presence on Earth. I started as an art history major, got a BFA, went to interior design school, went to architecture school, went to sustainability school. I've always been curious about all the different layers to play. Studied so many different things just because I wanted to feel, have people feel more, be out of fear in their homes or their lives, or after even working at NASA in the 90s, I saw how stressed out they were. I knew how stressed out I felt in all the homes I lived in here, because I never felt like, many of us, I never felt like I was from here. So I bought and flipped about 50 houses, thinking that from age 19 on, thinking that that would make me feel more connected, more grounded, more anchored here to earth. Never really did. Now I understand why. As a 72-year-old, I really get a lot of the information now that I had to learn over the decades, step by step. They said, Mary, you can't not remember everything at once. It's too overwhelming. And you've been through programs in my lab and ritual abuse from age 3 to 10. I have been through like a lot of weird stuff, like a lot of people here, that I left all the creepy part to the last couple of years of me learning. I'm doing a lot more regressions I'll get to in a minute. But so here, my first degree was a BFA, Bachelor of Fine Arts in Art and Art History. And at the age of 18, I took an art history class, and I saw these images, which was another reminder of my guides guiding me directly to see these images to help me remember what my mission was, what my passion had always been. So, you know, we put the pieces of the puzzle together step by step as the veil for ourselves and our journeys become clearer and clearer. And I guess maybe a lot of us, I did anyway, we left really some of the creepy parts to last, because it was much more fun than going off to them, which you'll see in a few minutes. But anyway, I've always been fascinated by culture. So here, as we see, we know from the beginning caves and petroglyphs, that was always about the ETs. It was the driven, how does culture work? It is driven by the intersection of peoples. It's all about people and how the peoples all work together, right? Really. And I've been trying to figure this out when I was doing this presentation over the last several months, going, what is it? There's so many layers to this. People aren't going to understand some of the things that I've done. Off-planet habitats? How do you weave all this stuff together into one? But I am, you can believe it or not, I believe it. I thought I was crazy my whole life. I still do partly, but I know this is my truth. And we're here today, all of us on the planet right now, to play our part, to tell our own truths. And people can believe it or not. And I'm finally coming out of the closet, the ET closet I call it right now, after 72 years of hiding. coming out more to share my experiences that might open up other people's as well. So, again, humanity has sought to understand and transmit to future generations the meaning and purpose of our existence as expressed in art, architecture, religion, and philosophy. I'm not going into philosophy or religion today, but I am diving into the art and the design part, because to me it's all is pretty much the same. Art to me is a mini portal that triggers emotional connection to your inner and outer space, inner self and outer space. Art enhances our experiences in life and makes our environments more colorful, personal, happier, and enjoyable. To me, art is a critical element in any living space. I don't think people really understand the power of art in spaces. It changes lives, homes, communities. We know from, you know, not only cave dwellings, but out on the streets, you know, we are always trying to express ourselves, to get rid of our pain, to allow more information to come out of us. So I've taught art therapy, and I've taught suicidals, and I've taught at hospitals, to allow people like me to get to heal, to touch in those inner parts of ourselves that are so hard to reach. And during COVID, thankfully, not thankfully, a lot of us were forced inside. I got calls every day from 50 years of clients, interior clients, saying, Mary, what do we do with the space? I said, well, first of all, you've got to make it, it's got to be a lab. It's got to be a school, it's gotta be a live-work environment. People, parents hadn't been living together. I didn't have to live with my kids crammed in, and my kids are in their 30s, my kids are in their 30s now. So I noticed when all my projects shut down during COVID, my design projects, you can't do interior design in senior housing or someplace in Italy, or I was working on a project in China, everything shut down. I went in, I went, okay, time to dive in to the icky part that I had glimpses of my whole life, into some of the ritual and my labby kind of part. And I did, and they keep, the guides keep telling me, you don't really need to see all of it, Marianne. I said, yeah, I guess I really don't, I'm over it. But anyway, these, to me, here's some samples also of my art here. My love of water, of space, of color and natural beauty. That one on the left is a photograph, and I don't know who upstairs helped create these weird images. That was not in, when I was speaking at the Beverly Hilton Hotel pool. Those images, some of this, they turned it into a painting for me somehow. Thank you. And then the middle one is just one of the first collages I did during COVID, trying to sort of visually creating my love of color. I see millions of colors, and a photograph that I had taken, you know, 30 years ago living in college just with my kids, or 15 years ago. And then just the love of space and the energy of the cosmos and the movement of it, the dynamics of it. And I just won a little art award for Mill Valley. That one on the right is going to be part of the rotating depot, which is one of the four artists they took, which I'm excited. And I just was showing that only because of the beautiful life that we live here. People complain about California and the homeless. Yes, I worked on homelessness for 35 years. But when we go outside and connect with nature that is free, it is outside every day, it is right there for our picking. I mean, we all know how much that, how important Mother Nature is to listening and caring for the birds and butterflies and watching the changes of the seasons that we've had really this year more than any. But art is an important tool for weaving all the layers of our lives together. I grew up with engineers, architects, and artists in my family, which fueled my passion to not only make art, but get training in art, interior design, and I did 2 years of architecture school, and then I got hired by NASA, and I thought, great, that's perfect, I can quit now, because I don't know how to do all those weight loads and all that stuff. So I didn't get my AIA, but it was I was on a track, not as an engineer, but as my own way, my own early path to get to NASA, which was my always my dream to work for NASA, which I did, and was really incredible. Loved the years that I worked there. Anyway, my dad was intimately involved through his grandfather's company, then his father's company, through Cook Electric Company and labs with early space programs. They worked on the reentry systems. They designed reentry systems and all parachutes and from rocket ships. They did a lot of the Apollo optics in the 50s and 60s. I grew up every night at the dinner with him complaining about the Russians back then, which we're doing now. But he was this incredible, modest, hardworking man, and I just sat and listened to him, and he would sit outside and look at the stars at night and point out everything. And he was a sailor, he was captain of crew of Princeton, we had sailboats. We lived in a big house right on Lake Michigan, and we were always out on the water and looking at the stars and swimming and just loving Mother Nature that we did, like many of us do. It was just really incredible to have such access all the time to entrepreneurs, basically, and creative men and women around me that were really not saying, Mary, do this, but I was just eating it all up, as we all do by our families. And it was helpful for me that I had really positive parents. So I got other stuff from other things, like we all do. We all are up and down dealing with good and evil in our lives, but I got a lot of positivity, and then also we always get the ugly, weird stuff that gives us the balance in life to understand what our hearts do and to be able to be more responsive to other people's needs. My mom's DNA was also pretty interesting. She had a distinguished lineage, and I'm not doing this to braggy about anything, I just what I grew up with, and I was so fascinated that you could do like really big developments when I was little. So anyway, our lineage goes back to William Bradford, who was one of our country's founding fathers, came from England on the Mayflower, and was 8 generations of Plymouth Rock governor and stuff, which was sort of cool. And then another relative was, to bring it more locally, was Roger Lapham, who was the 32nd mayor of San Francisco from 1942 to 1946. So my family did a lot of pioneering work in many areas that included teaching, politics, a cattle ranch in Kansas and Texas that Pancho Villa finally took over. He did many of the American ranches back in the day, but it got him to move to Arizona and then to California and do a lot of stuff out here. So I don't believe being born into this family was by chance. It gave me so much exposure to the world and with otherworldly opportunities as well. We can show others to keep their hearts and minds open to the possibilities many of us have due partly to our bravery, our openness, to be the explorers of new ideas, new lands, and cultures. We are here now by plan. Why I share this today is to remind myself and others to break out of the old patterns and not to fear, but dive into the future with hope, love, and a sense of adventure. I did that growing up, and I'm so grateful that I did. My father spent one day in 1951 with Werner von Braun when he was working with a company on and off for several years in Area 51, discussing and reviewing materials and craft samples. The picture on the right is representation of what they were hoping to discover at the time. What is the craft made out of? How do we replicate it? How do we replace this? How do we, you know, make it? Reverse engineering and all that. He was 32 at the time, and he said it was unbelievable spending a day with von Braun, even though we met him many times. He said it was just incredible. So they went with five other scientists, classified Air Force brass, Dad said, several smart university professors. They had several 2 or 3 inch samples that they were reviewing, and some minerals from Earth that they had nearby from the couple of crafts that he said was very exciting. And he said they met in underground in long claustrophobic corridors with many flights of stairs and very hush-hush. And he said it was very confusing, but really amazing. And he said, you know, and he's just told me the last few months, he said, Mary, I was 32 at the time. I was told to keep my trap shut, never to say anything, and I never could. And he said, I said, did you ever talk to Werner von Braun about ETs? And he said, yeah, we both discussed it twice that day, short little blips, because he said we were being listened to and watched by everybody. But he said, we saw a couple, Dad said, the next trip that I'll talk about in a second, he saw a couple of ETs and dead ones. And but they talked a little bit about their experience because, you know, Werner von Braun was very involved in space, so that was sort of interesting hearing for that recently. So these were images of what space looked like when I was growing up in the 1950s, like a million years ago, that I still love. These were very innovative for the time. They're H.G. Wells' War of the Worlds movie that he did with Disney, Werner von Braun and Willy Ley's space station rendering here in 1952 at the top left, and these space colony concepts are just really wonderful to see, for me anyway, these old pictures. Dad had 4 more trips to Area 51 in 1952, 1954, 1961, and 1967. Those trips, visits were mostly covered topics of ET materials, crashed spacecraft, and the missile program, which was now getting into the more full swing that he was involved with. The United States War Department, Army Services Forces, Corps of Engineers, awarded a project to a worker at my dad's company, Cook Electric, who had participated in work essential to the production of the atomic bomb, the Manhattan Project, dated August 6, 1945, which is in that picture right there that I found in the basement, too, that was about to get thrown away. Proof that both good and bad does live side by side in progress and in war. My father ran Cook Electric Laboratories in research and development involved in electronics.
Thank you, Sorry.
No problem. Ran research and development department involved in electronics, radar, nuclear physics, servo mechanisms, upper air research, weather reconnaissance, sonar, celestial, inertial navigation systems, aerodynamics, and allied fields. Cook, I found out recently, I found this article I've been researching for decades to find one thing on my father's company. This is the only thing I found 6 months ago. From 1952, from a research meteorological society in Mozambique. And it actually said my father's name, which was, you know, there's a lot, companies were allowed to be hush-hush back then, right? And I couldn't believe I actually saw his name there and where they, what they did. They had 10, I knew they had several plants around Chicago where we grew up, but I didn't know they had 10 massive ones. And I was particularly, I didn't know that they were that big, at 30,000 to 140,000 square feet. So remember, this is 1952, and they were already exploding, so they were doing a lot of work with the government, a lot of work with the military, a lot of work with the Navy and with the military in different ways. My dad was at Princeton studying under Einstein. World War II broke out. He went and became a lieutenant and a pilot in the Aleutians, where he met Oppenheimer, who had already met meteorology school that they were training him. Then he went back and did a little bit of Princeton, and he had become friends with Einstein at the time. So I think that those relationships just continued. Because my one uncle told me that he started his secret space stuff in the Aleutians, but haven't really gotten there yet. I have so many questions for him, I will get to that later. But anyway, so, and then I was delighted to find out when I saw, I was looking up information and I found a little slide rule from Cook Electric Company on Etsy. It popped up like 2 months ago and I went, holy cow, remember that? And Dad's
black suit, white jacket, you know, engineering glasses.
And it said Vandalia, Ohio, and I'm going, that's where Wright Patterson is. So I looked it up online, like, duh, it was like a stone's throw. And they had a lot of hangers there. So that was crazy.
Quick question. Would you say all the so-called military intelligence and, you know, secrecy still exists today?
Yes. I mean, I'm getting, and he's kind of yeah. passed about 8 years ago, but I talked to him now up there,
yeah.
or here, I did. And he said they're still asking him questions. The military still comes to him, the ET still come to him, they all keep asking questions about all these different things. He said he's still trying to figure out World War II, which I love. I said, Dad, that is so new. They're still trying to problem solve, like the most complicated things. I got a few of his vibes, but not that one, not the electrical brain. But so anyway, and they also had at that time, which I found really interesting when I found this article, was that they had over 400 engineers, scientists, and technicians that were part of the research division staff, that if they needed them on call, in these two pages that I found, they were always available. That's a lot of people to be going out and doing all this research. I have a lot to unpack in the rest of my life. So I will keep you posted next time about what I learned more from with that. So his grandfather started the company in 1897, and obviously NASA wasn't there then, but they were also doing a lot of work. My mother's father was an architect, as I mentioned, and he also had a huge lumber company, and they used to make coffins for World War I, because his father had that company. My parents grew up in the same town outside Chicago, so they met in the fourth grade, and then so there was these two big Chicago families that had these sort of overlapping worlds in design and architecture and design build and all that stuff. And so anyway, I guess he was doing a lot of coffins, and then another company was Woodruff and Edwards, where they were making propellers. So since nobody talked about it, I don't know all the details. I'm just learning. I've had like bunch of conversations with Dad. I have a lot to learn. So I'm sorry, I don't know more. So this is the second page of it, which I thought was really interesting. Look at the pictures of the flight simulation that they had at Cook in 1952. And the bottom picture I love, because I've spent my whole life in model shops building big architectural plans and stuff for the projects I've worked on. And so that and they did a lot of work. You can see there, it says the Office of the Naval Research. And that, I love that picture, that supersonic sled under their chest and their reserve base. So I have to keep moving or I'm going to run out of time here, talking too much. This is just a quick mention of who started Sherman Oaks, which was my great-grandfather. After Conchavilla took over his ranch, he went and developed a lot of Arizona, Prescott, down to over and then moved to California, and with Chandler and Otis started Sherman Oaks, and they developed down to Hollywood. Maybe you saw the movie Chinatown or read the book Cadillac Desert. They really they built railroads, they developed the whole thing, really screwed up the water in Southern California, which was too bad, but that was development, so good and bad come out of everything. But anyway, so, and then his father, Roger Sherman, was a shoemaker turned congressional colonial activist. I love that he was a shoemaker, became an activist, and he also helped write the Declaration of Independence and the Articles of Confederation. So my off-planet trips continued at age 10 in 1961 and began my training really to help humans and ET design their habitats off-planet. And I'm still getting glimpses and learning about this more and more, but why did they want little old me to work on sub-planet habitats? I'll talk about that in a minute. But so these are, this is a sampling of just a few, couple of dozen maybe visitation of a timeline for art design consulting that I've been doing in the planets of off planet in our solar system and beyond, asteroids and craft. That I'm not an engineer, I'm not a like total brilliant, I'm not God. I don't know how to explain a lot of these things other than I've had a lot of regressions and a lot of help for my guides telling me about these things that I do and where I go. Can't make this stuff up. I don't make up anything. I'm a Midwestern girl who's always told the truth. So I'm just telling you my truth. So this is just a small timeline from when I was in, from 1956 when I went on that craft with Dad. So, and this is just a sampling of 1956 to 2023 of some of the trips and locations that have been taken off planet by the Pleiadians, Arcturians, Andromedans. Mostly the Pleiadians or Arcturians, but it doesn't matter. They take me in all different forms and take me out there, and I've been doing it for a long time, and they evidently like it. So the next question is, how do you know this? I don't know how I know all this. I have done regressions with Barbara Lamb, who I did a book with, Misha Johnston. During COVID, I went nuts. I'd already done past life work over the years. I went to my first astrologer at age 19 in Boulder, Colorado, and I'd run business in India for 10 years, and everybody would come up to me and go, baby mama, star seed. It was like, oh, too weird, too weird. But I kept researching that I was a doctor in Atlantis, I was an architect in the pyramids. I've done a lot of research, but mostly I wanted to know what I was doing on these off-planet habitats, other than they watch everything, and they saw me at NASA, and they know me, my family, right? We all have different DNA for different purposes, and they use us for different things, and incorporate us in different things that we know. So anyway, the Pleiadians, I went off physically, I've been transported into distant lands, they fly and reconstruct my body. I'm mentally connected to distant places without having physically going there. I mean, many of you are probably way more advanced than I am. I've just been doing this really for 3 years, deep dive. So give me some time, I will learn more, but it's been pretty wild. And then memory gaps. Due to my childhood trauma from government programs, sexual abuse, 30 electric shock treatments, I remember some of that, like having my whole brain was going to be exploded. But then at age 10, I was on a craft, and I remember them putting stats and math. I said, what are you putting in my head? And they said, math and stats. And there were. So anyway, there was always this blend, which life is no good and bad, that we go through to get to where we are today. And I'm thrilled to be here today sharing these stories, because we all have good and weird ones, I suppose. And there's this me at age 6, with my grandmother used to make all my clothes, and that was my first zoot suit with I only like black and white still today, like 70 years later. And I wanted her to make a belt, because that was my astronaut in me, and of course my shoes untied. But that was one of the first of many of my space outfits that my grandmother made for me for Halloween and stuff over the years. That was sort of fun. And that's my mom and my dad. My young kids are now, my two kids are in their 30s. Lizzie works at Salesforce in London. She's a global community manager, so she connects dots all day long. She's thriving with philanthropy and education for people globally. And my son is 34 and works at the Presidio Trust and is planting, does forestry forever. He loves forestry. He's planting the seeds and the plants for the future of the Presidio Trust and to other people. So it's great that they incorporated some of all of our family passions into what they do too. So I had contact, it's taken decades to figure out who I am and what I am. I'm still figuring it out. I've had contact with a few of my hybrid, with my many hybrid children in nighttime travels that can only remember their details with the help of my guides. I recently learned that I have about 40% retention of past memories of my life due to the programming processes that delete remembrance of ET contacts. I don't remember most of my childhood, and I only through these pictures have been able to put some of the pieces together. Many of us gain our insights and information from our ET contacts through hypnotic regression, as we know, or other means, as I did with Barbara Lamb and others. Hypnosis is a wonderful tool, unlocking information and discovering hidden experiences. Through it, I learned about my encounters, my design work, and my hybrid relationship with ET. I continue to seek and ask for more information of what has happened to me, and get many downloads all the time recently, like we all are more and more now. The more I ask, and even more importantly, the more I listen. I've got to flip through the rest of this. I'm going to have to just show you. I've taken about 125 trips off planet. Sorry, I visited Venus last summer. They asked me, they said, Mary, what would you do with this space? I've been doing off-planet subsurface interiors. So, and that's obviously, it's all a cave and dark and cold and the little pockets underneath. So I have to go really fast here. It looks, a lot of them look like that. And they actually, I was taken many times to discuss, review the progress of these spaces over time. So I've just got to keep moving here a little bit. I visited the sun 2 times. Yes, you can go inside the sun. Only because I've been in the sun and it is a livable environment when the ET shifted vibrationally for me to go there and for others to go there. The first time I went, 16 months ago, the Pleiadians took me there to view the progress of the colors that we had been looking at in this space. There were a lot of beings, Pleiadians, Syrians, other work volunteers like me. The group was advancing technically, or was very advanced technically. They're creative and are sensitive to the emotional needs of the populace, which are ETs and humans. Spaces that are live work environments for full-time and part-time people. They use these places as stopping gaps so they don't have to fly all the way to Pleiades. They're stopovers. And they're going to continue growing and expanding in space, and that's why they're doing it now, because they're expecting a lot more visitors over time. Right? So within this one, we developed an accent wall. Why am I working with ET? I've brought on off-planet design. I love it. I love any kind of design that's helping all of us to work together. I feel a lot of the emotions. I feel of emotions, we all do, and with this big room, we created a display on the wall. I went back to the sun, and it was even bigger the second time I went, about 8 months ago. There are 10 different villages inside the subsurface. We are working on a synthetic building. There was about 60 feet tall. The different areas were research, academics, food prep, as you can see. Anyway, they are very, they grow their own food. It's fascinating to see how different the different plants and the different beings obviously all eat differently and want different spaces and different colors according to.
There's a message that's going to die.
You need to find a remote.
Oh, thank you. Oops. I'm just going to keep going. Sorry, I'm just going to keep going because I don't want him to go off. Well, you can keep looking. I'm just going to keep going with this because I still have about 10
people. As long as you have some motion going, I think it'll.
Okay. It's not doing it. It's not going away.
Over getting close to the end.
5 minutes? Well, I know, but this is, I'm sorry guys, I was talking too much. So here's a tower of the Pleiades, which I'll go quickly through. This is, I went on 2 Andromeda spacecraft to enhance and work on their design and art. I visited Pluto and Saturn twice, 2 weeks ago, working on their interior. They are, a lot of the planets are now adding more conservatories for food, for greenhouse environments to be able to walk into and experiment with making different types of food. I have hundreds of hybrid children that live on and off planet in all different areas. Here are some of them right here. These 8-foot tall ones live on an asteroid. The middle ones, I'm just gonna have to whip through these, I'm so sorry. These are the Asperians that live on Cygnus constellation. They're the blue people. I have about 25 hybrids who live on a 4-mile-long spacecraft. These are three of my hybrid children that live in China and what they do. I have two in South America that are all of these are in their 20s. I felt like I was pregnant really like my whole life, which was pretty crazy. But anyway, from early on, they have this many kids.
Visit them?
But I've never visited them. They don't know them. I've only talked to a bunch of times four young Pleiadian kids that I have in the Pleiades. They haven't reached out to me, and I don't reach out to them. If they want to reach out to me, hopefully they will at some point. But I talked to the young kids up there. They were so excited to meet me because we've been doing some art projects back and forth, designing clothes and furniture and stuff. I did a book with Barbara Lamb. I asked her to do a book with me a couple of years ago. That's me on the cover, who I saw. And our book is Positive Stories of Kids' Adventures with ETs in Space are based on real accounts from her thousands of regressions that she's done over the last 60 years. Since I was never spoken to my whole life about my experiences, I wanted other children and parents to be able to read a book where they could say, oh, I've seen one of those, I've seen Little Gray, or just to open up the conversation. We've gotten a lot of great feedback from this, and Barbara, after I met her, I said, would you please do this with me? Did a bunch of regressions, we became friends, we're still friends, and it was just really wonderful. I feel like children are future leaders and voices and activists of our country. We have to focus on them to prepare them and give them the tools and the skills and the open-mindedness to stay present and guide the future. We've goofed up our earth in a lot of ways. We've kept so much information from them. We have gun violence in the schools. We need to teach them well, prepare them for the next stages when more ET come and live with us. And share with them, no, we're gonna be living together, we already are. And the ET want me to help them come to Earth as I'm helping them off, us go off planet, they want me to help them come to Earth and find out locations. I've already been doing talks on that. I'm on Conscious Awakening Network. You can find me on Connecting with the Stars with Mary Edwards. This is a new show that started about 6 months ago. I've done about 50 interviews. Any of you have any interesting stories to tell, let me know. I love interviewing people and hearing their stories. And then thank you so much for coming. And I guess this is the end of the talk. I was commissioned, contracted to do this poster with my Golden Gate Bridge and the Pleiades and craft above it, put for by Lorian for her UFO con recently. Anyway, thank you so much all for being here. I really appreciate your attendance. And I'm sorry I'm talking so fast and got into the story too much not to be able to go over many of these parts. But thank you so much for being here.